Hello, folks. This is James LaRance. Wanted to talk to you about something that's extremely controversial, and it always has been, as far as I know. I haven't been around since even before Christ and so forth like that. Of course not. I'm a 59-year-old man. I was not in existence before God sent my spirit into my mother's womb, and I became a living soul. And we have no other reason to believe that that's not the case and that that's not how God does that. But anyway, I wanted to say that there's a teaching that I have taught on occasion called the Genesis Gap. Look through my videos and you'll find, I think, probably two of them. Some people have a very strong, opinionated disagreement with it. And I kind of understand that. However, years ago, probably back in 1981 or 1982, I found a book. And it was by a man who used the Hebrew language in his book. And he showed where the original Hebrew and so forth, Greek, Aramaic maybe even, were showing that something did indeed happen. Now I'm going to, first of all, do you remember Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 and 2 that says, "In the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was upon the face of the deep, and the Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters." Okay? Well, there's scripture that was translated into these linear-type Bibles. Now, one of these I'm going to read to you, I remember it saying it was some type of Jewish society. Okay? Now, these are the people, the chosen people of God, that know their languages quite well. Right? And let me read one that's the concordant literal version of the one I just quoted from King James. It says this, "Created by the Elohim were the heavens and the earth. Yet the earth became a chaos and vacant, and darkness was on the surface of the submerged chaos. Yet the spirit of the Elohim is vibrating over the surface of the water." Okay, that's the concordant literal version. Now notice it said the earth became a chaos and it became vacant. Now that means it was occupied before it became vacant. Now this other scripture I'm going to read, it's actually not this next one, but the one after that. I want to give you three references, okay? Because Jesus talked about in the mouth of two or three witnesses shall every word be established. Now, he wasn't applying that to everything, of course, but to that specific thing about gaining forgiveness from your brother or getting forgiveness, or giving forgiveness to them if they have not listened to you as yet. And you go to them, and then if they don't listen, you bring other people. So that's that scripture. But what I want to do is try to help you to understand why some of us really see strong merit in this teaching. In fact, I have accepted it. And you say, oh, you're false for that. You know, people have used and they throw around that false teacher tag a whole lot. And they do that in order to glorify their own position. Now, the real position is God's position. And it is perfect, inerrant in every way. And it is God-breathed. Okay, and I believe that wholeheartedly. Now, does that mean I think that the English, you know, Hebrew and Greek, Aramaic, these languages were the original? And of course, there's Latin versions and so forth. But these original languages, especially Hebrew for the Old Testament, is as original as you can get as far as mankind is concerned. Men are always imperfect vessels, but man, I tell you, when God is anointing them and leading them, they're going to come pretty close. And the Word of God itself is perfect. Okay, I can't say that enough times. But now read, I'm sorry, not read, but listen to me read this one also from the Hebrew Linear Bible. And, you know, it shows the Hebrew language. I'll show you very quickly, and then I'm going to read this. But do you see up there, you see the Hebrew symbols, and then you can see the English down below that. And it says this in the same Genesis 1, verses 1 and 2. In the beginning, he created Elohim. Now, it's not saying he created Elohim. It's saying he created, and that's backing up and and explain to you who he is. It's the Elohim. Okay, in the beginning, he created, Elohim, the heavens and the earth. And the earth, she became chaos and vacancy and darkness over, it got cut off right there, I'm sorry, over, well, the face of the deep. Some say over the abyss, you know that? And the spirit of Elohim vibrating over surfaces of the waters. Now, the main thing is here that I just want to show you. Well, I tell you, this Hebrew language, it would be hard for me to even begin to pronounce it. Like Bi, Rashith, Bra, Aliim, Ath, Eshim, Ata, Earts. See what I'm saying? So anyway, what it's saying is, in the beginning, God created. In other words, it's saying he created, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. It then says she became vacant in chaos. Now, why does the Hebrew sometimes refer to things in the female gender? It's probably because the earth brings forth the herb yielding seed and all these other things that keep us alive. It's like nursing. You know, a baby nurses from its mother and it keeps the baby alive. We eat things from the earth and it keeps us alive. We have these dirt bodies. So we eat things that come from the ground. You know, plants don't, you can plant just a seed and that's all there is there. But as it's in the ground, it grows into a plant and can grow into a mighty oak or whatever else like that. Redwood, tree, whatever. That's extremely old and very solid. They can build a bridge underneath them in a hollowed out area of the tree and cars can go through it. That's how big they get. So it's pretty amazing. So the earth, she became chaos and vacancy. Now that means it wasn't chaotic, but it became chaotic and it became vacant. According to this scripture from the Hebrew, that some translators translated into English for parallel versions, para meaning beside, you know, beside of, beside the original. Here's the English, okay? The Bible was not originally English, okay? I'm sure you know that. Now, it says she became chaos and vacancy. That means it was occupied before it became vacant. Darkness over the face of the deep and spirit of Elohim vibrating over surfaces of the waters. Now, this third scripture I want to read you. First, I read from you the concordant literal version and then this Hebrew parallel, or it's actually called the parallel linear Bible. Now, this one, now the heading of it is Bereshit, Genesis, the beginnings. Now, I remember seeing that some Jewish society had put this one out. So I couldn't find that reference this time. I'm sorry. However, this is from Hebrew scholars. Okay, it says, in the beginning, Elohim created the heavens and the earth. And the earth came to be formless and empty, and darkness was on the face of the deep, and the spirit of Elohim was moving on the face of the waters. Now, some people say, but here, I'll blow away all these references. You know, in the mouth of two or three witnesses, every word shall be established, but I'm still going to blow those all away. Because it says in Exodus chapter 20, verse 11, for in 6 days, now this is New International Version. Please let somebody let me know if the King James, which I thought this is what this was that I copied offline. But it says in the NIV, for in 6 days, the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea, and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. He made it holy. Now, folks, what this is showing here is that you have to see it this way because this is how the scriptures are actually trying to convey this to us. God, in literal 6 days, I believe that. I've always believed that. Okay? Now, except for when I was a teenager and I was had wandered from God, me and a friend would talk about this often about, hey, why is there so much evidence of extreme age of the earth? Well, some people say God made it. Young earth creationists say he made it with the appearance of age. Okay, now, you may think this is crazy to say, but I am a young earth creationist, and at the same time an old earth creationist. How can that be? Let me tell you how that jives together. Okay, I believe that Adam's domain in which God gave him all the authority over all that he had created in those 6 days. He said, I want you to have authority, be over every the fowl of the air, the fish of the sea, everything that walks, creeps, swims. Okay, so he was giving him that, and he said to subdue it. And so Adam was to do that. And so my belief is that the scripture in Exodus, and I need to look and see if it only says the heaven and the earth, as it says in Genesis chapter 1, verse 1, in the beginning God created the heaven and the earth. Now, I'm trying to remember if it's plural in this one or if it's singular also. Regardless, the heavens, Paul talked about going to the third heaven. So there's the first heaven where the fowl of the air are. The second heaven has the firmament of the clouds and so forth. You don't see birds often going that high up, but the clouds can go up pretty high. Now, you see airplanes do it. We see spaceships going in. That's still the second heaven. The third heaven is where Paul said that he went when he saw the throne of God. He saw things that cannot be uttered by a man, uttered by our speech, and man cannot conceive of it with his hearing or his eyesight on this earth. And he said they were that great. And he began to be a little puffed up, as he says in the scriptures. I think that's in one of the 1 Corinthians, probably. He talked about being puffed up because of the knowledge that he had, and God sent. God didn't send, let me take that back. God doesn't send Satan to do anything he allows. There's a huge difference in that, whether people believe it or not. He's not really using Satan as a tool to do these things, but he is going ahead and allowing him because man allowed him first to become God of this world. It wasn't God that gave him godship of the world. It was Adam. Okay, little g, 2 Corinthians 4:4, the God of this world, the present God of this world, little g. Okay, that's Satan. Okay, that was man's fault that this happened because he disobeyed God and bowed to Satan, literally, by obeying his words, because he was only supposed to obey God's words. He was commanded to obey God, and he didn't. And that command was so that man could prove that he honored God and that he wanted God as his father and as his friend. And because you remember, God came in the cool of the evening. He walked with Adam and talked with him and in the cool of the evening and so forth. So they were friends, yes, and he was also God, his father. My dad's my friend, but he's also my dad. So you can see the parallel there. But folks, what I'm trying to say is there are people who will jump on that false teaching soapbox, and yet people have legitimate reason to see that this could have very strong merit. In fact, according to these Hebrew scholars, that something did happen, and the earth became chaos, and it became vacant. I had a friend who once looked in, I believe it was Strong's Concordance, and he said, I wanted to see what all words could fit into that one that was stated as, and the earth was without form and void. And he did see where the word was can also mean became or to become. Okay, now he told me that, and he said that him and his pastor looked at it. Okay, now, so this is all I'm saying, folks. I just want you to know why people believe that. They have legitimate reasons for it. And there are scriptural reasons within the King James. You know, I believe it is an excellent, it's my favorite translation. But God's word itself is inerrant. And, you know, some people say, no, the ESR or the, is it? Yeah, I think that's, or the ESV, whatever it's called. That one is closest to being absolute perfect toward God's word, which mankind cannot, they can get very close to perfection as far as translating. But will they be absolutely perfect in all things like that? Well, when human vessels are involved, no. Am I saying, so therefore you're speaking against the Bible, are you, James Lawrence? I just told you. No. I love the Holy Bible. It is my favorite thing on this earth other than the Lord himself, okay, that who resides in my heart through the Holy Spirit. And I believe in him, his death and his burial, his resurrection, his death by bleeding his blood out for us, for the remission of our sins, taking the sin of the world upon him, and then after dying, being raised from the dead. I believe that with all of my heart. You know what? That's the only truth that matters to me that much. But I do study these doctrines too, and other people do. And I don't think we should be calling them false, because there are legitimate reasons. And there are ones within the King James as well. If you look at all the correlations that are made when someone gives a full representation of the Genesis gap, which I have in a couple of videos, if you want to look them up, and if you don't, just move on from here. But I did that so people would understand why there's people who believe in what's called the Genesis gap. There's a guy that, because they call it the gap theory, there's a guy that has a book out called The Gap Is Not a Theory. I happen to believe what he says in that book, for the most part. I mean, pretty much I do agree with him. But he is also imperfect, as I am. And none of us will have the perfect answers on every doctrine. I don't think at any point in time men are in too much disagreement. And they'll be in disagreement about this. I had a book signing one time at a Mardell store, in which I brought my stacks of my book called The Genesis Gap, a Comprehensive Biblical Study, because I go into a lot of detail in it. It's kind of like in three sections, and I go into detail on each section. Kind of a little bit of a different view, you might say, but not different from each other as far as how I'm putting forth the doctrine in that book. But just, I got three sections, and they're named, titled a little bit differently, so you can see the different aspects, is a better word, not views, but aspects of the teaching. Okay, so anyway, that's all I really wanted to say. I just wanted you to understand that we who believe this, as I did when I received a man's book back in about 1981, and he gave different Hebrew original language words, how these were placed in there. In fact, it was called the pre-Adamic creation, I believe it was what it's called. I don't think it's even in print anymore. The man passed away, and I haven't seen that book. It was more of a booklet, but it was pretty good, because he stayed on these scriptures here, and he did give some others about how God did not create the earth without form and void and so forth, and it's the same word. Or he didn't create it in vain, and it's the same term that's translated without form and void in Genesis. Okay, so he created it not in vain, but to be inhabited. Now I'm going to go ahead and close. I just want this to be about 18 minutes. So thank you. God bless you for hearing, and I hope that gives you an understanding of why some of us believe this. I remember a lady saying at that book signing I did years ago, in a different state even, and she said, "Do you know Kent Hovind, or Hovind, however it's pronounced?" And I said, "Yes, I do." But I thought, what does that have to do with what I'm putting forth here? But anyway, thank you guys for listening to me. I appreciate you, and God bless you. Talk to you again soon. Bye-bye.